So welcome to the keynote of our workshop. I invited the speaker is Abram Hindle from University of Alberta in Edmonton. He's a professor of green software engineering, I would say, over there. In 2017, he has received an award from the Mining Software Repositories Conference for early career achievement on setting up a new line of research, green mining, which is about connecting software changes to energy consumption, energy efficiency, power consumption of software. And that links very well with our community. And I'll give the word to him without further ado. Thank you very much, Abram, and the floor is yours.
All right. Thank you very much for introducing me. I really appreciate that. I hope you all can see my screen. And I hope that I'm in the bottom corner of it. Anyways, so this talk is going to be Thoughts from a Decade of Energy Consumption Research. I'm Abram Hindle from the Department of Computing Science at the University of Alberta in Canada. So in general, I'll just introduce myself in terms of what motivates my research. I have a lot of interests on the computer. I've always liked computers, and these interests have typically fed into my research. So I've always really enjoyed programming, and I take part in programming meetups, and I help out with developer meetups in Edmonton, where University of Alberta is. And I combine that with my interest in music and computer music and HCI for computer music. And then that kind of interacts with software engineering, machine learning, and statistics, which are both very useful for HCI in computer music. And that also gets combined with signal analysis. So I like playing with signals a lot, and that lends into my research. So my research often feeds back into my music itself. So a big chunk of my research is empirical software engineering, and a big arm of that is mining software repositories, which is basically spying on programmers based on their changes, so looking at their Git histories, things like that. I also do a lot of research on the naturalness of software. So that's the application of language models to source code as if source code was a natural utterance. But a big part of my empirical software engineering research is software energy consumption. That is, what load, what work software induces and is usually powered by energy. And then I also got my computer music and signal processing versus software engineering, doing a lot of research right now in visual programming languages, both in music and not in music, as well as recently I've gotten into signal analysis on ECGs, so machine learning on electrocardiograms for diagnosis and prognosis. And prognosis is more fun. It's kind of like, are you going to survive the next 30 days? Which is a lot more interesting than saying, oh, you have RBBB. Anywho, so this is the overview of the talk. I'm going to talk about software energy consumption research, which is a kind of small slice of computing sustainability. I'll talk about my lab's work in the area. I'll give a couple of do's and don'ts, or don'ts and do's, and then I'll check out a couple of free research proposal ideas at the end, and we'll conclude. So we're on to software energy consumption research. All right, so fundamentally, most of our computing nowadays is the conversion of information and electricity into information and heat. The use of transistors as gates means that we take electricity and we take a signal and we convert it into another signal, and a waste byproduct is heat. That waste byproduct is going to be a good portion of the energy that we put in. So that means a bunch of energy is being used at every transistor to act as a gate to do computation. So it means just about every bit of computation that we do nowadays is the conversion of energy, which is really interesting, but it does have a side product. It has heat, and it means it consumes energy. It takes work to actually do computing. So to compute is to do work. And it's not just the CPU which uses energy. Our memory uses energy. Our wireless networks, our wired networks use energy. Our disks and I/O use energy. Powering a bus uses energy. And on mobile devices, the screen uses a lot of energy. Actually, my screen on this computer is 32 inches, which is definitely using a lot of energy in terms of the backlight. So the work that we ask, say, a light bulb to do is going to be the similar to the work we ask a computer to do. But fundamentally, computing consumes energy. And this might not be a problem if our energy was sustainable. I don't know if energy is sustainable where you are, but where I am, at least 80% of our energy is from coal-fired power plants. So they use coal, they burn it, so that causes CO2 emissions, and it causes PM2.5 emissions, which is kind of a big deal. And then they transmit that energy over the transmission lines. I get it through my smart meter, and then I use it to power my computer. Now, the utility company only gives me a bill for the whole shebang. They don't give me a bill for my computer specifically, but I can probably tease out what my computer costs. I know when I was deep learning for about a week that I incurred about $11 in energy costs just by having that GPU running for a couple of days. Okay, when we're computing, there's two different ways we can look at the energy consumption of computation. And they're related to each other, but some views are better than others given the task. So if we're talking about a continuous service, like your computer running, or the cost of work, or say a web server, or a service running on your computer, or you're playing a video game, that would be a continuous task, right? So you're consuming energy as long as you're doing those things. Now, you might consume more energy if you're doing more of those things at once. This is a lot like you using a light bulb. So if you turned on a 40-watt light bulb, it would be doing continuous work, and it would be doing 40 watts instantaneously as long as it's on. Okay, so it's always, its power is 40 watts. So that's kind of a continuous action. It costs that much as you use it. But in computing, not everything is continuous. Lots of things terminate, lots of things end, lots of things have a limited timeline. So in the case of, say, file compression, moving a file, storing a file on disk, rendering a video, storing a JPEG, encoding a JPEG, all of these kinds of things, those would be tasks, and they would definitely have power. You could measure their watts while they're running, but they have a start and an end. And so in those cases, we will refer to their consumption as energy consumption, because they are consuming energy over time. So in order to calculate energy, what we'll do is we'll measure their watts, and we'll basically integrate over their watts over the time that they operate. And that integration is going to be basically joules. So a 1 watt second is basically 1 joule. 1 watt hour is 3,600 joules. And if you multiply this by 1,000, you can get a kilowatt hour in joules. Kilowatt hour is just popular with utilities. So we've got continuous tasks, and we've got tasks that start and end. And so when a task starts and ends, we can calculate the energy. If a task just keeps going, we can still calculate how long it's been running, but we often will talk about its power, its immediate and instantaneous work. All right. So that's kind of interesting, but why would we care? What would we do about this? Well, if we measured energy about applications, we could do things with applications that we do with things like stoves and microwaves and refrigerators and things like that. If we measure the energy of applications, we could rank applications for their efficiency at doing certain tasks. So imagine the scenario where we have super boring email app and we have super exciting email app. Super boring email app, it's boring. It doesn't have any animations. It doesn't look pretty. It does the job it's supposed to do, and there's no ifs and buts about it. It's just kind of an unpleasant email app. Super exciting email app, on the other hand, is AI augmented. It has animations. It looks great. It will complete your emails for you. In these cases, what we might find is that super email app for reading emails is very efficient because it doesn't do much. It just shows text and then goes to sleep. For sending emails and writing emails, it might be very efficient. For receiving emails, it might be very efficient. Or a super exciting email and its AI agent, reading emails and using your sound card to read it out to you might be expensive. and for sending emails and the writing of emails, because you're using that large language model to run super exciting email, it might be very expensive. But for reception, it's pretty good. So I would love to have a system, I'd love to have a world where every bit of software that I download, I have this profile so I know. And I'd love if this profile was communicated to consumers and end users and developers. So that would be really, really excellent. A world where something like Energy Star or Blue Angel existed for everything. So that was one of the motivations why software energy consumption is pretty interesting and why measuring and estimating software energy consumption can be interesting. Okay, so let's kind of talk about the area, what you kind of expect to do. In general, a lot of software energy consumption research, again, a small slice of sustainability research, needs to measure software. A lot of it's about dynamic analysis. A lot of it's about running software as it runs, or measuring software as it runs. So in my lab, we use the Green Miner to measure software. And the Green Miner is basically this thing here is a phone. This is Raspberry Pi, and it's just measuring. It's getting information from an INA chip that's measuring energy consumption, and then it's communicating it to a Raspberry Pi who communicates to a web server and produces a report. So these kinds of things are useful for queuing up tests to be run, running a test, and reporting back to energy consumption. But what this is, it's whole system measurement. Unfortunately, it doesn't really give us component level. I can't directly blame particular chips on a phone for consuming energy. Also, because it is whole system, it might be difficult to get source line resolution measurement. And there's research about how to do that, about running it repeatedly such that you can get estimates of what exact lines of code actually cost in terms of energy, or what libraries are actually consuming energy, or detecting which libraries are probably running based on their energy profile to blame them. So there's lots of interesting stuff in research and blaming source code for consuming energy. So one thing to be aware of is like one model doesn't really fit all. You've got different platforms like Windows and iOS and Linux and Android. You got different processors, ARM processors, x86, RISC, all sorts of stuff. You got different displays. You have different peripherals like Ethernet and Wi-Fi, sound cards and GPS. And then you got to take all these things and you got to chuck it into a model. And you hope that the model can maybe produce the energy consumed or the instantaneous work or what methods are actually consuming energy or blaming lines. Or maybe you just care whether or not your new version to the app has a change in energy consumption. So this leads us to basic challenges that the whole area faces. And one issue is community, which is, it's really nice to see your workshop operating. And I think the European community is a lot more into sustainability at the moment than the North American one. So we've got challenges in community organizing, where do we publish, where do we share information, that kind of stuff. We've got challenges in shared data. Now there's some recent stuff, like I think it was Green Hub and things like that, where there is data sets that are now available, which is really nice. Because in, say, building energy consumption, the energy consumption of buildings, there's a lot of shared data. Not great data, but shared data. In our space, there's not a ton of data, so it slows everyone down because they have to measure things. Shared tooling. Nowadays, I would say software developers have all the options in front of them for estimating energy consumption dynamically. So Battery Historian from Google does a really great job. It's a great profiler. It's usually tuned per device, so it's very nice. Then there's also Xcode. Xcode can do a lot of stuff. We have lots of issues with methodology. One of the issues that you face in software energy consumption is that your tests take time to start, set up, and measure, and tear down. And so this means it limits the numbers of runs you can do. So if you go look in performance computing research, they often like a lot of runs, and they will often have runs that are very short, so it can run hundreds and thousands. This isn't really great if you're trying to do end user stuff. So you get limited number of runs. And what does limited number of runs give you? Lack of statistical power. So we're dealing with that. And we're seeing the same kind of thing in AI research right now, where, I don't know, they get away with a lot more, frankly. You're able to publish a paper where you've trained a neural network once and evaluated it once, and you don't even have error bars or confidence intervals about your performance, well, at least in software energy consumption research, it's expected that you're at least running your tests at least 5 times. Maybe you can detect a 20% difference there. And then another challenge that faces the community is kind of a lack of benchmarks. We have like the programming language shootout and we got some other stuff, but they're not good energy benchmarks. And the spec benchmarks, they're a start, but they're not, I don't think they're totally appropriate, to be honest. And so we have issues in benchmarking and what's appropriate to measure and what contexts matter. So these are challenges that face software energy research. Then more on the methodology part, what are we going to measure? How are we going to measure it? There's holistic measurement, which is what most people engage in. We measure the entire system on its own, and then we induce a load and we measure the entire system plus that load. And that causes a problem because this load, like your operating system and the background stuff, can be pretty big and it can kind of swamp out your task. If your task is pretty small, you might have to run your task a lot. Then you might have questions about peripherals, Wi-Fi, GPU use, network cards, hard drives. One nice thing now is that CPUs, like Intel CPUs, come with RAPLs, so you can get information from the CPU, at least about memory energy use, as well as CPU memory use. And GPUs. GPUs tell you how much how much energy they're using now. Maybe not at a fine-grained level, but you can usually get measurements from there. As well as server power supplies will often report their energy consumption, but usually at like a per second granularity. Now, you might wonder, why do we care about measuring the energy consumption of a run multiple times? Well, there's a lot of non-determinism in computing, and essentially, we're now hitting a physical process. So this is probably one of the few times we actually get normal distributions in empirical software engineering. But it does mean that we have to rerun things again and again to get statistical power. And you can get non-determinism from a variety of sources. Your location can actually change your results. The starting state of your CPU, its current state, the current voltage, as well as the current frequency of your CPU, and what your governor does, because it can go from an energy-efficient slow mode to a high-speed, energy-consuming performance mode pretty quick, this state really determines how much energy your computer is going to use. So do you pin it at high performance and measure that cost, or do you want to see if it pushes your CPU into high performance? And you have to make that decision. If you're doing anything in the cloud with networking, anything with Wi-Fi, you deal with EM issues like people using the network, congestion, microwaves. You also deal with network congestion. And if you ignore all that and you think, well, I just got a file system in memory. Well, you get file system fragmentation. You get memory fragmentation. Every time you write to the file system, unless you're totally wiping the whole thing, you've got a new system. It's kind of different. So there's a lot of non-determinism to deal with. So if we're doing all this measurement, that's great, but why do we do measurement after the fact? So there's a lot of push into dealing with sustainable requirements, with dealing with sustainable design, dealing with energy consumption at design time. And so you could consider energy-friendly patterns and architectures. So imagine the observer pattern where a model exists and it has watchers. Every time the model updates, it updates its watchers. So this means that if a model updates frequently, all these watchers have to wake up, and that consumes a lot of juice. So one way around this would be, say, a kind of model view presenter pattern where the model has a proxy for it, and the proxy receives updates from the model, but it doesn't notify the watchers all the time. It'll, say, queue them up, and then once in a while, it'll notify the watchers. And then that way, you can be asleep more often, and you can save energy. So these kinds of architectures and patterns can be used ahead of time in order to reduce the energy consumption of your app before you even have a chance to do dynamic analysis. Now, this goes into analysis itself. There's different granularities of analysis you can do. And if you do software defect prediction, this is pretty obvious as well. So some developers will want fine-grained granularity. They will want source-level blame for energy consumption. That might not be useful to someone who is dealing with an entire product and has to deal with lots of classes, and they might want class-level resolution. Or you're the system architect, and you really care about which components of your software ecosystem are consuming the energy, so you really care about the architectural level, the service level. And so you can do all granularities of analysis, but different ones require different behaviors, different kinds of measurement, that kind of stuff. But you got to kind of choose this before you start. I would say developers are kind of in a tough spot for making their software aware of energy consumption while it's running. And what developers do need is energy-aware frameworks. So frameworks that either offer green options or have the ability to be tuned at runtime to choose green options if allowed. So you could imagine a framework which is taking the battery into effect and is tuning certain parameters. Like it might be a neural network library, and they might be saying, we're going to take a hit for accuracy in order to reduce energy consumption. It might be a randomness library, and they're like, we can accept a hit on randomness if we do this. It might be a physics sim. You might accept more inaccurate physics on a lower energy system. Or it just might be something that just like GPS, where you accept less updates. But you have to have these tuning parameters, and the frameworks require monitoring of energy consumption, and then you got this real trade-off you got to make of balancing performance and energy. Okay. Let me just see. No messages, so everything's good. All right. If anything goes awry, just pop in with voice, because I can't see you. All right. Another problem we're dealing with is the fact that most of the software we have now is not measurable. In the sense of it's running in containers, it's running in virtual machines, it's running in the cloud, on shared cloud infrastructure. So we can't put a multimeter onto that cloud machine because it's, you know, running lots of things. We could go buy a machine and run our own cloud, but that also wouldn't really be realistic, would it? So if we wanted to truly be fair, we might really want to measure in the cloud itself. So the question of like, what is the cost of multiple containers? What's the overhead of containers? What is the energy induced? We have to estimate that energy because we can't actually run it. So the cloud computing is really fun because we care about the energy consumption of cloud because it's so heavy, but we can only really get away with estimates. So this brings in questions of sustainability and economics. So in my view, if we really want to motivate sustainability in computing, it does have to be on the balance sheet. It does have to show up as a cost, whether it's a monetary cost or reporting of, say, CO2 emissions. So some companies, they will report to you their I/O, their CPU, their memory, their network usage, and they'll charge you for everything. But they won't charge you for energy because they're wrapping energy into all of these subcomponents. And that's okay, but it means that you can't optimize for energy, and they don't give you the chance to, and you don't know if they're optimizing for energy, so you don't have the chance. So knowing how much energy you're using and the cost of energy can be really important. It doesn't necessarily have to be money. Companies might make carbon pledges. They might say that we are going to be carbon neutral. In that case, they might not care about the cost of energy, but they might care about their energy consumption, as well as their CO2 output from their processes, such that they can accommodate that by greening up, by saying planting trees or paying some other company or buying carbon offsets. So I think one big way to really motivate this whole field is to make sure that data centers and cloud providers are actually giving us that signal, which will allow people to actually optimize for energy. And then there's the whole topic of this workshop, questions in education. It looks like you're all making headway, which is really great. I got to say, in North America and at my university, it's not great. I teach the undergrads a little bit about how to make energy efficient phone apps. And I teach them a little bit about what induces energy consumption with software, but not a lot. I teach the grad students a lot more. But that's not a lot of grad students. My grad course is only every 2 years. So, you know, my impact's relatively low in this space. And what we know is that, frankly, they need that education. All the surveys of developers have basically shown that they pretty well need it unless they're embedded software devs or they're, you know, relatively mature devs in a mobile space. So, software energy consumption, lots of challenges, really fun. Software is a measurable electrical effect. We got to measure that. There's lots of fun stuff we can do. So I'm going to move on to what my lab has been up to. I'll just check the time. Okay. So in my lab, we started off with the Green Miner, a framework that allowed us to measure multiple devices at once and queue up tests. It was initially just for Android. My student Abdul Ali over here, he's on the market, definitely hireable. He's doing his postdoc at Queen's. He just got his PhD recently. He did an iOS Green Miner. So he used a Monsoon to measure an iOS device. It reports back to a computer because we needed Xcode. And then the computer reports back to the web service. So it's very similar to the Green Miner, except this one was iOS stuff. And if you're interested and want to make your own iGreen Miner, he does have a GitHub repo. Okay, so I'm going to talk about a couple of pieces of research that I found interesting, that I liked, that my lab did. It's not everything we did, it's just some things. So this study was about energy consumption of machine learning on Android devices. And this one's a little dated and old, so just accept that. We went and we looked at mobile apps in the App Store around 2016 and 17, and we found by decompiling them that they used a lot of linear regression, they used a lot of regression, a lot of face detection, they used Common CV a lot. Some used classifiers, Apache Commons math was common, and handwriting detection was actually really common in apps at the time. Google was just releasing downloadable models at the time, so TensorFlow wasn't that common. There wasn't a lot of TensorFlow, but basically 4% of the popular apps in 2017 used machine learning. I'm sure it is greater now. I'm absolutely positively sure about that. Now, so what do we propose to do? We propose to take a bunch of machine learning algorithm implementations and a bunch of common machine learning data sets for benchmarking, and we wanted to know which ones were optimal, which algorithms were optimal across all these data sets. We set up tests and we sent them to the Green Miner and we got their energy traces. We ran them many times such that we get a good estimate of energy consumption. And what we wanted to produce was the Pareto front. And the Pareto front is basically a shape in space whereby you have a dominating result. So every one of these star results are dominating. So we have higher accuracy over here. We got better, we got more energy consumption over here. So we want stuff in this space. We want highly accurate and we want low energy consumption. These triangles are dominated solutions because at any point there is a solution that consumes less energy and gets better accuracy. Whereas these points on this edge, this Pareto front, these points, they have the best accuracy for that level of energy consumption. So most people think, why would you care? Why wouldn't you just use the most accurate? Well, what if you actually did engineering and you actually made trade-offs between the resources that you had? This is where the Pareto front comes in. And I think ideas like the Pareto front are really important now because we have a bunch of kind of questionable solutions and we have many solutions that are pretty good. So if I had a library that tuned for energy, I might want to know all these algorithms such that I could give the end user that fine-grained tuning that they wanted. So we did it. So if we look at kappa, which is basically probabilistic accuracy versus evaluation energy, so this is the running on the test set, we find that 0R, who doesn't do much, was the least consumer and least accurate. J48, decision tree, was doing pretty good for energy consumption, pretty good for accuracy, followed by logistic regression, and then a multi-layer perceptron. Support vector machines didn't do great. Random forest didn't do great. K nearest neighbors was excellent on training, but pretty poor on evaluation. Now, this is all interesting until you realize all these algorithms are already modeled. We already understand them a lot, and people have worked out their complexities. So if you just look at the big O model of these algorithms, which chucks out a bunch of extra stuff. So this is only like looking at the highest polynomials, right? It's the big O estimate. What we find is it correlates. Big O correlates just fine. So all my measuring energy there, not really useful. I could have just measured runtime. So, and I could have used Big O to estimate it. So that's a really kind of meh kind of result. But it does say maybe we should watch out for runtime since, you know, energy is power times time or power integrated over time. So maybe we got to address that. Now you're thinking, oh, you're just using Weka. What about if we use TensorFlow in a real network, like an inception network? And well, the inception network has lots and lots of weights. And if I was going, I would hand wave away neural network inference, forward propagation as a big O of W, where W is the weights. So it's linear in weights. So if you have a million weights, you're going to have like really nasty energy consumption, but you already knew that ahead of time. So that was fun. It was just an exercise. It was kind of a benchmark. But my students do better work than that. That was done by Andrea McIntosh, who's at Google, and Safwat Hassan, who is at U of T. My former student, Shaiful Chowdhury, he's a professor at University of Manitoba. He was really interested in measuring software as it runs in order to estimate energy consumption in the absence of, say, a multimeter or any physical hardware measurement. So what he did is he measured stuff from the operating system, like syscalls, and he made models that estimated energy consumption based on the syscalls. And what he found was that he needed a lot of data to get a good, accurate regression model that would estimate energy consumption in terms of joules. So what he did is he engaged in random testing of apps to produce random and genetic testing of apps to produce test traces automatically, such that he could build a data set of 400 applications that were tested, and then he could use that data to produce models. And this plot here shows the more apps that he trained on, the less error he got. So once he got to about 23 apps, his error was around, I don't know, 15%, which is pretty cool. So he really liked doing that, and he then changed gears just slightly, and he thought about what should we do at design time? Can we do design patterns that will actually save energy consumption, or can we take design patterns and save energy with them? So he took the model view presenter pattern, which is like the observer pattern. It's kind of like MVC. Model view presenter is different than observer pattern because it has this role of the presenter in the middle. The model has state. The presenter is like a controller and it can modify the model state. The model will update the presenter. The presenter will notify, or the presenter updates the views and so forth. And so what we can do to make this more energy efficient is we can make the presenter go to sleep. And that's really important because if you have events coming at rapid rates, right? You're going to be updating your UI too much. And updating the UI too much, like faster than, say, 30 hertz, is kind of a waste of time. We can perceive 60 hertz, but we can't read at 60 hertz, so what's the point? So what Shaiful did is he tried three strategies with the presenter. One is to not queue anything. One is to queue stuff up and bundle it at different frequencies, so 30 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, 200 milliseconds. So every like 200 milliseconds, he would go and he would send his views the new updates. And he also had another strategy called dropping. And what dropping does is it chucks out the update information and just queues up one update and it tells the views to go and get their information. And so there was a lot of savings of energy when you reduced rates or you had at least 30 milliseconds of queue time. So by allowing the system to sleep for 30 milliseconds, you had considerable energy performance gains, which is pretty cool. My student Abdul Ali Bangash and his co-supervisor Kareem Ali, they're really interested in not doing dynamic analysis. They want to do static analysis. They wanted tools that could estimate energy consumption rather than measure it. They wanted to jam these tools in the IDEs, in the cloud services, in the testing services, continuous integration. And so Abdul Ali, during his PhD, engaged in essentially three exercises of bytecode transformation, suggestion, and optimization, providing guidelines for iOS APIs, as well as static analysis for estimating energy consumption. So his first task, he wanted to apply bytecode optimizations to take an existing app to make an energy efficient app. And so what this would do is, after you compiled your Java code, you'd make an optimized version of the Java code before it got packaged into an APK. So he used a Facebook library that had 17 transformations. And the problem was, is which 17 are you going to use? Because using them all is not going to actually give you the optimized version. So he made a search-based solution using generic algorithms, and he was able to optimize existing apps pretty well, between 0.5% to 11% using generic algorithms. But what he learned from this is he didn't like dynamic analysis because it took too long. So it really motivated him to do more static analysis. So on that path, he decided to look at the Apple Location Services API and see if he could provide guidelines to developers ahead of time. So kind of design time guidelines. And so he went and he checked Apple documentation, and Apple said, hey, processing, networking, location, and graphics are the biggest consumers. So you should optimize for these in order to save battery. And so he looked at location, because location is very popular. And the iOS location framework has a bunch of little configurable knobs. You can use the standard service, the visit service, the region service, or significant service, and you got some parameters there. So you had basically, you had quite a lot of choices here, right? Your choice in distance filter and desired accuracy, combined with these four choices, you could have hundreds and hundreds of configurations. So he went to the documentation and he saw what Apple said. And they said the visit location service is the most efficient, significant location is most efficient for live locations, standard location use more power. So what he wanted to do is he wanted to do that Pareto front, but he wanted to optimize for how often you get updated about position as well as energy. So a three-dimensional Pareto front, kind of interesting. So he set up an experiment, basically going from the West Edmonton Mall to another mall, very Edmonton thing to do. And he set up the experiment, he put on the green miner. Each of these configurations got ran five times, and he produced basically a better than graph. And what he found was the visit service is the best, is best, while standard service was the worst. Default configurations were usually not great. And yeah, he produced a better than graph where configurations dominated others. So it was kind of like the Pareto front, but in graph form. And he optimized for low energy consumption as well as high location access rate, which is really neat, because high access rate implies high events. High events usually imply more energy consumption. So if you can get less energy consumption and more events, that's pretty cool. That usually doesn't happen. So that was kind of exciting, which, I don't know, energy consumption research exciting isn't always the norm. Anyways, he went and applied these recommendations, and he changed real world apps using his recommendations. And he was able to save between like 0.5% energy and about 12%. Next up, he wanted to analyze your software for API use. And based on your API use, he wanted to warn you if your software was using more or less energy than before. And he wanted to do this with static analysis. So he set up an experiment where he was going to take APIs, profile the tasks of the APIs, produce an energy profile. Then an end user would download these energy profiles. His application would analyze the call graph of their software, determine what API calls they're using and if it's in loops and things like that. It would then use this energy profile to estimate energy consumption and calculate a value called E factor. How does it work? Well, you make a benchmark. So for SQLite, we did insert, read, and update, and we measured one call, 10 calls, 100 calls, 1,000 calls, so forth. We benchmarked that, got good numbers on this, and then we share that profile with the E-factor calculator. So using his SWAN framework that Karima Lee's lab has worked on that works on Swift code, you detect API calls. So this is in a ONTAP listener for an iOS program. It has an SQL insert and a read. And then what you do is you give the end user an estimate of, if you know that they're going to call it 1,000 times, this is the expected E factor of your insert and your read, and your insert and read together is about this. Using this number, you can compare it to the previous number of the previous version of your app and determine if you're using more or less energy consumption than before, right? It's not necessarily directly joules. It's close, but it's relative. So if you get a higher E factor than before, you're using more energy than before. And this is really useful because it's static analysis, because you could run in the cloud, because you could run in continuous integration. It could be a bot on pull requests, all kinds of fun stuff. So what was his result? He got about 16% mean absolute error. It works pretty good. It works as fast as compiling the application, so that's nice. And is strong positive correlation there. So that was work from my lab, and frankly, I did a little bit, but these students did almost all of it. So energy consumption students were Steven, Scheifel, Chenle, Eddie, Ali, Abdul Ali, all were doing energy consumption research. Okay. So I promised that I'd give some advice about energy consumption research. And so I'm going to shoot from the hip a little bit here. And I apologize. I looked at a bunch of your CVs, and I know that I'm probably going to step on some toes here. So apologies ahead of time. And I'm actually required to do this as a Canadian citizen. I have to say sorry. All right. So green neural networks. They're boring. Please don't do green neural networks. I read a lot of ML papers, especially neural net papers, and they always say, oh, our network is green. The reason why they say their network is green is because they made a smaller network than the previous one. So of course it's green, because according to Big O, you know, there's less work to do, right? And, you know, unless they do something fundamentally interesting, like say change the activation functions or something like that, it's going to be green if it's smaller. We're basically Big O of W, where W is weights. So if you reduce the number of weights of a network, typically it reduces energy consumption. If you reduce the complexity of your activation functions, if you quantize the network and use smaller numbers, yeah, it typically uses less energy. So did you need to measure energy? No. You already had a good model of it. You don't need to measure anything, right? It's kind of dull. So what should you do instead? Do engineering. Balance the trade-offs. Take energy consumption and take, say, an evaluation metric and balance the two, or a task performance metric, and talk about the Pareto front of parameters and which networks are more appropriate given certain contexts, because you might be on edge, you might be on GPU, you might be in the cloud. Talking to the cloud might cost you. There's a network cost, all this kind of jazz. Do the trade-offs. Don't just say, oh, we got a better latency network. That just meant that your network was smaller, right? Like, it's not really that interesting. It's more interesting to delve into the trade-offs and accept the fact that not everything has to be accuracy for accuracy's sake. And when we're in this world of, say, large language models, whereby they're really hard to evaluate and they produce crazy answers, we might not be able to even tune for accuracy. There might be just, you know, better setups. So that's kind of interesting. So if you do green neural networks, try to do the engineering trade-offs. That's my tip. Don't ignore time. A lot of energy consumption research that I read is kind of unnecessary, because if you just did the runtime benchmark, it would have correlated really, really heavily with the energy consumption measurements. So energy is, you know, the integration of power over time. So time is a huge component. If something takes more time, it usually takes more energy. So the correlation's really high. What should you look for? Doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. What should you look for? Green up, not equal to speed up. That's interesting. So that means something that uses less energy and is slower. Something that is faster and uses more energy. Those are interesting. Those two quadrants are really interesting spaces. And we saw some of that in parallelism and concurrency research in that Haskell Greenland paper, whereby they were looking at parallelism and concurrency monads and seeing that there was actually really interesting interactions. But you also get interesting interactions with peripherals, cache interactions, tail energy, anything where you offload to other systems. Really interesting. I know I presented a benchmark paper already, but my suggestion is don't make another benchmark paper. Blog posters like Michael Larrabee at Forenix, they're great at benchmark blogs. And I know my students love these benchmark papers, but they don't last and they don't really leave knowledge for the community to build on. So what I tell my students is think about writing an energy paper that will be valid 10 years from now. Not necessarily the actual measurements. Like, what if Android just goes away? What if Android goes away? What can someone take from your paper once Android no longer exists? So that's what I ask them to do. And so in those cases, they can deal with things like trade-offs, but they can also deal with things like context. So consider questions like, does Rails scale better or worse than Django versus is Ruby more efficient than Python? I'll tell you right now, I know that Ruby's less efficient than Python. And programming language shooter already told me that. So is that really important? But is that really fair to Ruby, where it's used oftentimes as service software to make web services? It's not necessarily being used for heavy computation. So the domains that we're operating in are pretty important, as well as the context. So don't ignore time. Time is a primary component of energy. Energy is the integration of power over time. So when apps use, when tests and apps and benchmarks use more time, typically they use more energy. There are cases where that's not true, though. There are cases that are really interesting. So what I suggest is accept that time is heavily correlated with energy, but look where you're green up, basically how much more green are you getting, is different than your speed up. When your green up and your speed up don't measure or don't correlate, or on opposites, it's really interesting. So this means something that consumes less energy but takes more time. So this could be something as simple as, oh, I ran a neural network locally on the CPU. It took more time, but it didn't use my real beefy GPU. You could also have cases where energy consumption is worse, but the speed up is great. So maybe I used three GPUs at the same time and I got the answer really fast. Those kinds of things are really interesting. But we can also get these kinds of disconnections with our UIs, parallelism, concurrency. And there's a great Greenland paper about Haskell monads and how concurrency monads can have these kinds of interesting interactions between green up and speed up, as well as anything about peripherals, anything about cache interactions, tail energy, all that fun stuff. Now, it's funny that I'm saying don't make another benchmark paper, because I just kind of showed you a couple of those. My students love making benchmark papers, but what I tell them is this a blog post? Will this survive 10 years later? If it's not going to survive 10 years later, say after the destruction of Android or something, then maybe we shouldn't really bother with it. It could just be a technical report. So what should we do instead? Well, we could actually start thinking about the context of use, the context of how something would actually be used. For instance, Ruby isn't used for scientific computing that much. Ruby is used for running Ruby on Rails nowadays, most of the time. So to compare Ruby against, say, C might be pretty unfair. So maybe it would be better to consider things like, does Ruby scaling fare better or worse than, say, Django Python scaling? This is a bit more interesting than, is Ruby more energy efficient than Python, which is effectively kind of benchmarking, because both of them can change. So what can we do? We can look at contexts that we could evaluate them, like say for a mobile app, are you on vacation? Are you at work? Are you on the plane? Are you in the field? These have different kind of network environments and power environments. We can also look at specific domains and model specific domains, and that might be a bit more of a fair context and trade-off. One thing that we need to be aware of is developers know how to use profilers, and profilers exist for developers. Battery Historian exists. It's very good. Here's a Firefox profile. Here's Battery Historian screenshot. Developers already know how to use profilers. So if you're doing what a profiler does, maybe you should integrate with the profiler, or maybe you should provide that information elsewhere, like in continuous integration. Like when you give a pull request on GitHub, it could be a bot that basically runs energy consumption regression tests. And this is where the static analysis really shines. The fact that we don't need to run on the same system. We can run it in the cloud. We can just get an estimate. So that's pretty cool. And that's related to Ellie's work. So I think static analysis definitely in this area definitely needs more work, and it needs to be deployable. Okay. So those were do's and don'ts. Some little bit negative, but hopefully you took something useful from that. Let's look at the magic eight ball, and let's prognosticate about research proposals that one could do in this specific area. So what we're seeing now is that devices are really complicated. They're heterogeneous. They have many kinds of CPUs, GPUs, neural units. Now we have actually scheduling problems and dynamic scheduling problems, which is a whole new interesting area. So how do we split up work either at compile time or runtime such that we can take advantage of the processors available to us or take advantage to offloading to the cloud and maybe even grid edge devices? So this is an interesting area. There's work being done on it, but there's a lot of work to be done. I think the economics side is really interesting, and I think there needs to be more interaction between price signals and software and software developers and end users. I would love to see cloud services talk more and more real time to applications. I'd like that stuff be, I'd like those signals to end up in software development, and I'd love for the signals to end up in the App Store. Users should be able to inspect at any time and see what app and maybe what part of their app is actually consuming energy, especially if it induces other services to induce energy consumption. The field that I helped found, green mining, the characterization of energy consumption change over time, hasn't actually got a ton of research in it. And we have fundamental questions about like the statistical distribution of changes in the wild that induce differences in energy consumption. We know causes of energy consumption, but we don't necessarily know the proportions that people encounter, things like that. So that's like a whole PhD thesis right there. I really want serious attention given to certification of software itself, whether it's apps, software services, cloud services. I would really love Energy Star or Blue Angel certification for apps, for software, for anything that I download in Debian, anything like that. And then what this workshop was kind of focusing on, how we communicate these things to developers, to users, to stakeholders, what are effective mechanisms of doing that, as well as what this workshop was about, training developers, how do we help them do it, and how we help them do it earlier. So I think we've got a lot of good stuff in sustainability requirements, but I don't think we're great at design. I think we're missing a lot there. So that would be my suggestion of focus. So thank you for your time. In conclusion, I presented the area of software energy consumption, which is a subset of sustainability and software. I presented the work of my students, especially Abdul Lee, who's currently on the market. You could hire him. And I talked about do's and don'ts of energy consumption research, as well as I gave a couple possible research proposals. All right. I look forward to hearing your questions. Thank you for inviting me.